Hey, Shalom Israel, Captain OC,
Officer Elijah,
and we're back with another episode of 15 Minutes with the Captains. Today we're going to dive into the issue of Jonah and the king of Nineveh, because people are trying to use Jonah and what happened in Nineveh to say that God now loves all nations and all nations can be saved. So let's prove that wrong. The first thing we want to establish is that Jonah was indeed an Israelite. Let's go to 2 Kings 14 and verse 25.
2 Kings chapter 14, verse 25.
He
restored the coast of Israel
from
the entering of Hamath unto the sea of the plain, according to the word of the Lord God of Israel.
Of Israel, read.
Which he spake by the hand of his servant.
His servant who?
Jonah.
So Jonah was his servant. All right, Jonah was his servant. When you go through the lineage, we obviously know it'll trace back to Israel. But let's see who the servants of God are. Let's go to Leviticus 25 and verse 55. Because a lot of people think that God uses anybody and everybody. He talks to everybody. No, that's not right. Read that.
Leviticus chapter 25, verse 55.
For
unto me, the children of Israel are servants.
Read that again.
For unto me, the children of Israel are servants.
Unto God, the children of Israel are his servant. So Jonah was a chosen servant and prophet of God. Now, let's go on to Nineveh. Why was Jonah sent unto Nineveh? A lot of people just think it's just that was the enemy of Israel. He didn't want to go preach against his enemies. He didn't want redemption for his enemy. No. No, that's not why. Let's show you why he went to Nineveh. 2 Kings chapter 15 and verse 29.
2 Kings chapter 15, verse 29.
In
the days of Pekah, king of Israel,
came
Tiglath-Pileser, king of Assyria.
King of who?
King of Assyria.
Read.
And took Ijon and Abel, Beth, Makah, and Jonah, and Kadesh, and Hazor, and Gilead, and Gilead, and Gilead, all the land of Naphtali.
All the land of what? This is key now.
All the land of Naphtali.
Read.
And carried them captive to Assyria.
So our enemy carried northern kingdom of Israel, keep in mind, all of Naphtali into Assyria. 2 Kings 17, verse 4 through 5, and then we're going to jump down to verse 23. So keep in mind, the Israelites were carried captive to Assyria. Where? Read.
2 Kings chapter 17, verse 4. And the king of Assyria found conspiracy in Hoshea, for he had sent messengers to so king of Egypt.
Right, we were always seeking refuge from the other nations. Read.
And brought no present to the king of Assyria, as he had done year by year.
Read.
Therefore the king of Assyria shut him up and bound him in prison. Verse 5. Then the king of Assyria came up throughout all the land.
Throughout all the land. Read.
And went unto Samaria.
Uh-huh.
And besieged it 3 years.
So the king of Assyria was besieging the land of Israel for 3 years. Jump down to verse 23.
Verse 23. Until the Lord removed Israel out of his sight, as he had said by all his servants, the prophets.
Read.
So was Israel carried away out of their own land to Assyria unto this day.
They were carried out of their own land into Assyria. Now who was carried out and where were they taken in Assyria? Let's go to the book of Tobit, chapter 1 and verse 1. This is the history that they don't tell you. They don't tell you that the Israelites were dwelling in where? Assyria. Primarily where? The capital of Assyria was what? Nineveh. Read that.
Tobit chapter 1 verse 1.
The
book of the words of Tobit. Son of Tobel. The son of Aniel. The son of Adul. The son of Gabriel. Of the seed of Israel. Of the tribe of Naphtali.
Of the what?
Of the tribe of Naphtali.
Of the tribe of Naphtali. That's important. Go back to 2 Kings 15 and verse 29. We're going to tie these pieces together. Read that.
2 Kings chapter 15, verse 29.
In
the days of Pekah, king of Israel, came Tiglath-Pileser, king of Assyria. And took Ijon, the Abel-Mathaika, and Jonah, and Kadesh, and Hazor, and Gilead, and Gilead. All of the land of Naphtali.
And what?
All the land of Naphtali.
So what we're reading about is a first-hand account of what we're reading in 2 Kings 15. Of the tribe of Naphtali being carried into Assyria. Now go back to Tobit and read verse 2 and verse 3.
Tobit chapter 1 verse 2.
And
who in the time of Amanasseh, king of the Assyrians, was led captive out of Thisbe, which is at the right hand of that city, which is called probably Naphtali and Galilee.
Galilee.
Uh-huh. Above Asher.
Uh-huh.
Verse 3. I, Tobit, have walked all the days of my life in the way of truth and justice.
Uh-huh.
And I did many alms deeds to my brethren and my nation who came with me to Nineveh.
Who what?
Who came to me in Nineveh.
Who came with me to what? Nineveh. There were Israelites dwelling in Nineveh. Why? They were carried out of their own land during what? Shalmaneser, the king of Assyria, carried them out. There were several kings that took them out of the land, as we read in 2 Kings 17. Read.
Into the land of the Assyrians.
Into what?
The land of the Assyrians.
Into the land of the Assyrians. That's what happened. We were carried out of our own land into Assyria. So what did God do? He sent his prophet to go prophesy to his people, as he always have done. People don't know the Bible. Why did Jonah not want to go there? That's the next thing. They say, well, why didn't he want to go? Let's prove it. Let's go to the book of Jonah, chapter 1 and verse 2. Jonah chapter 1 and verse 2. There was a reason why he didn't want to go. It wasn't because he knew that God was going to save his oppressor. No, that's not why. Read that.
Jonah chapter 1 verse 2.
Uh-huh.
Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city,
uh-huh,
and cry against it,
uh-huh,
for their wickedness is come up before me.
Their wickedness has come up before me. So the land of Nineveh was a wicked land. Was that it on that?
Yes.
Now jump down to chapter 3 and read verse 4. So he was prophesied to cry against Nineveh. Read.
Jonah chapter 3 verse 4.
Uh-huh.
And Jonah began to enter into the city a day's journey. And he cried and said, yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown.
So the Lord told him to prophesy that in 40 days Nineveh was going to be destroyed. This is what he did not want to do. He didn't want to prophesy of destruction. Why? Now go to Jonah chapter 4 and verse 2.
Jonah chapter 4 verse 2.
Start at verse 1.
Verse 1. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was very angry.
Uh-huh.
And he prayed unto the Lord and said, I pray thee, O Lord, was not this my saying?
Was not this my saying? Now this is after the Most High said, you know what? I'm not going to destroy him. I'm going to give him a little bit more time. Was not this my saying? Read.
When I was yet in my country,
uh-huh,
therefore I fled before unto Tarshish,
uh-huh,
for I knew that thou art a gracious God.
For what?
For thou art a gracious God,
uh-huh,
and merciful,
uh-huh,
slow to anger,
read,
and of great kindness, and repentest thee of the evil.
Jonah knew that once he prophesied against the land of Nineveh, those Israelites that were in the midst of wickedness and the country, once he did that, he knew the Most High God would change. He was a merciful God. Not change, but he would give them more time. So what would that make him look like? That would make him look like he was a false prophet. That's why he did not want to go, because he knew God was going to be merciful. But I'm going to show you that what he prophesied did come to pass. It just didn't come to pass on his timeline that he wanted. All right, go to the book of 1 Samuel chapter 3 and verse 19. This is what Jonah did. This is what he wanted. He wanted his word to stand, which it did, but not in his time. Read that.
1 Samuel chapter 3 verse 19.
Uh-huh.
And Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him.
Uh-huh.
And did let none of his words fall to the ground.
And what?
Did not let none of his words fall to the ground.
And he didn't let any of his words fall to the ground. Meaning when he said it was going to happen, it happened. When he said this was going to come through, this, it came through. Jonah knew that if he said in 40 days this place is going to be destroyed and it didn't happen, they were going to look at him crazy like, hey, Jonah, you said this, you said that. Not knowing that the Most High God, his ways are not our ways. If he want to give them more time to repent, he can do that. But Jonah didn't understand that. All right, that's all that is. It wasn't because he was saving all nations. We're going to prove that. So let's go to Amos chapter 3 and verse 1. The people, who was he talking to when he went to Nineveh? We already proved the Israelites were scattered there. We proved that Jonah was an Israelite. So who do you think he was talking to? Amos chapter 3 and verse 1.
Amos chapter 3 verse 1.
Uh-huh.
Hear this word that the Lord has spoken against you, O children of Israel.
Oh what?
O children of Israel.
Read.
Against the whole family which I brought up from the land of Egypt,
uh-huh,
saying, you only have I known.
Ye what?
You only have I known.
The Israelites are the only nation that know God. That's what y'all failed to understand. Old Testament, New Testament, Apocrypha. He's talking to the Israelites. Read. Was that it on that?
Verse 2. You only have I known of all the families of the earth.
Read.
Therefore, I will punish you for all your iniquities.
Therefore, I will punish you for all your iniquities. Now, Psalms 147 and verse 19. Psalms 147 and verse 19.
Psalms 147 verse 19.
Uh-huh.
He showed his word unto Jacob,
uh-huh,
his statutes and his judgments unto Israel.
Read.
He hath not dealt so with any nation.
He hath what?
He hath not dealt so with any nation.
And he hath not dealt with any other nation as he did with the Israelites. Now, let's go to the book of Jonah, chapter 3, and verse 5. Let's prove that the message that Jonah taught was for the Israelites and the Israelites only. But as always, the other nations somehow hear the word and then they want to take heed. Read that.
Jonah chapter 3, verse 5.
Uh-huh.
So the people of Nineveh believed God.
They what?
Believed God.
The people of Nineveh believed God. What people? Read.
And proclaimed a fast.
Uh-huh.
And put on sackcloth.
Read.
From the greatest of them even to the least of them.
Read.
For word came unto the king of Nineveh.
Hold on, for what?
For word came unto the king of Nineveh.
So, Jonah didn't go to the king of Nineveh. He went to the Israelites that were scattered there. He heard about the word of, hey, what's going on? Destruction coming? Hey, we all need to fast. That's what happened. The word was not sent unto the king. It was sent to the children of Israel. Just like Christ. When Christ was out teaching, what happened? While he was teaching, the Syrophoenician woman came up and said, I know that you're the Son of God. Give me a blessing, O Lord. That's what happened. Did that mean Christ was sent to the Syrophoenicians and the Greeks? No. Likewise in this instance. Was that it on that verse?
And he arose from his throne.
Uh-huh.
And he laid his robe from him and covered him with sackcloth and sat in ashes.
So it said all the people believe. Now we're going to give you an example in another book where it's more specific. Go to the book of Esther. Give me Esther chapter 4 and verse 16. We're going to show you who those people were that called the fast. Read that.
Esther chapter 4 verse 16.
Uh-huh.
Go, gather together all the Jews.
All the what?
All the Jews.
Read.
That are present in Shushan.
Right, that are present what? In the land of their captivity. It just didn't say Jews in the book of Jonah. That's all. But right here it's more specific. Read.
And fast ye for me.
Uh-huh.
And neither eat nor drink 3 days. Night or day.
Right. So that's another example of the people hearing the word in captivity and calling a fast. That's what happened in the book of Jonah. But what? The king heard and he declared it for the whole city. Now, go to the book of Proverbs chapter 21 and verse 1. Why would the king call a fast, they say? If God doesn't love everybody, why would the king do that? Proverbs 21 and 1. What y'all fail to understand is the Most High God is in control of everything and everybody. Read that.
Proverbs chapter 21 verse 1.
Uh-huh.
The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord.
The what?
The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord.
The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. Read.
As the rivers of water, he turneth it whithersoever he will.
Right. And he can let the king do whatever he wants. That's just like Cyrus. He made him free all the Jews. Does that mean now all the Persians and Medes are free now? No. He does what he wants according to his commandment. From there, go to the book of 1 Chronicles chapter 17 and verse 20. So because the king called a fast, does that now mean that God is going to save all nations? Read that.
1 Chronicles chapter 17 verse 20.
Uh-huh.
O Lord, there is none like thee,
mm-hmm,
neither is there any God beside thee,
uh-huh,
according to all that we have heard with our ears.
Uh-huh.
Verse 21. And what one nation?
And what?
And what one nation?
Read.
In the earth is like thy people?
Read.
Israel.
Uh-huh.
Whom God went to redeem to be his own people.
Read.
To make thee a name of greatness,
uh-huh,
and terribleness.
Read.
By driving out nations from before thy people,
uh-huh,
whom thou hadst redeemed out of Egypt.
So what other nation is like the Israelites, whom God himself went to save? Read that last verse.
It says, for thy people Israel didst thou make thine own people forever.
Uh-huh.
And thou, Lord, becamest their God.
Right. So no other nation can lay claim to being the children of Israel, the children of God. Did that change in the New Testament? Luke chapter 1, verse 68. Let's see the salvation change now for all nations. We're going to start at 68 and read through 71. Read that.
Luke chapter 1, verse 68. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel.
Uh-huh.
For he hath visited and redeemed his people.
Uh-huh.
And hath raised up an horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David.
Uh-huh.
As he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began.
Read.
Verse 71. That we should be saved.
That what?
That we should be saved.
That we. Who's the we? Read verse 68. The children of Israel. You ain't got to read it. I'm telling them to read. Read.
That we should be saved from our enemies.
Uh-huh.
And from the hand of all that hate us.
And from the hand of all that hate us. Now, this is the most important point. Did destruction ever come to the Ninevites? That's what they never mentioned because they say he saved everybody. Well, let's see. Let's go to the book of Tobit, chapter 14 and verse 8. This is what they never mention about the story of Jonah and the Ninevites. Destruction came as it was prophesied. He brought destruction on his enemies as he said he would. Read that.
Tobit, chapter 14, verse 8.
Uh-huh.
And now, my son.
Read.
Depart out of Nineveh.
Do what?
Depart out of Nineveh.
He told him to depart out of Nineveh. Show you what? Once again, the Israelites were in Nineveh.
Right.
Read.
Because that those things which the prophet Jonah spake shall surely come to pass.
They knew what Jonah said. It was going to happen. They got a little grace period. But they said, hey, that prophet said that destruction was coming. Jump down to verse 15.
Verse 15. But before he died, he heard of the destruction of Nineveh.
Hold on. He heard what?
The destruction of Nineveh.
He heard about the destruction of Nineveh. Read.
Which was taken by Nebuchadnezzar.
By who?
By Nebuchadnezzar.
Read.
And Assyria.
Uh-huh.
And before his death, he rejoiced over Nineveh.
You see that? Before his death, he rejoiced over the destruction of Nineveh, our enemies. So never think that God loves everybody. You'll never read where he destroyed the Ninevites and then he said, I'm going to come back and save them. You'll read that about the Israelites. He destroyed us many times. But he always said, I have not done away with my people. I love my people. So, we pray y'all got an understanding on Jonah and the king of Nineveh. That's another session of 15 minutes with the captains. I'm Captain OC.
Officer Elijah.
Appreciate you for viewing. Shalom.
We used to scream black power while Heron was pushed. But at the end of the day, nothing's in vain. IUIC has been given a vision. The tents of Judah has risen. Many has attempted the mission, minor murmuring, omitting, and missing the mark. Just reading that he had the flame of fire in his eyes gave us the spark. We on Paul's mission. We out on the road, purple and gold. From Mexico, Cuba, Haiti, Ghana, Sierra Leone. 144,000 boots banging, concrete crackling. These are our men repented at heart. The scriptures is proof. IUIC, we deliver the truth.